Mic check.
Gotcha.
I think we're ready to begin. All right, good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Great to hear your voices. Welcome to the Inclusive Growth and Racial Equity Thought Leadership Lecture Series, and also welcome to the midweek point of Data Science for Social Justice Week. Raise your hand if you've heard about data science program. Raise your hand. All right. So for undergrad students, we have a master's degree data science program here at Howard University. My name is Dr. Amy Abuakwakume. I'm the director of data science program. And in the room, we have some of our students who are virtually online because our program is a virtual program. We have students from the continent in Africa. We have students in the Caribbean joining us. So give them a wave. Well, the camera's behind you. You can wave to our virtual students in our program. Our program has 40 wonderful students who are doing great work. That number of 40 represents a dynamic number, because our students are working on projects like Dorothy, working on a project on black women and breast cancer. We have a student like Ike who's working on black wealth and credit reparations. We have a student known as Lakita who's working on a project on climate change. Right? So we have great students who are doing great work in our program. And in our first year of our program, we're excited to have our second inaugural Data Science for Social Justice Week. And this week, we're highlighting the work of Dr. Safiya Nobles. Can I have a round of applause? Great place to clap. Before I go into the introductions from Dr. Major, this morning everyone kind of received a warning, the alert of the warning. And for me, these warnings at Howard are a bit triggering, because I remember November 15, 2015, when we had, my first warning of an on-campus death threat. I remember that warning vividly. And that woman was triggered from an issue doing attack social media and Dylan Roof, right? And that conversation around the impact of social media and algorithms and the impact it has on our death and on our life as Howard students, as Howard faculty and staff, is something that we're gonna talk about today. How we should think about, even after 2015, 2-3 years after Howard faced many other threats, right? That put many students and ourselves at risk, but for our mental standpoint, it was definitely very challenging to move forward from those points. So today, we're talking about the intersections of data science, social media, internet, engines, and how we at Howard are creating a space where students from political science, raise your hand, political science, sociology, raise your hand, English, history, computer science, are coming together to talk about data and the power data has, not just at here at Howard, but across the globe. But without further ado, I'll pass it to Dr. Major.
Good morning. My name is Dr. Monique Major, and I'm from the Department of Psychology, High Psychology. We're here in Durables, which I love. So I'm here to introduce Dr. Wutoh and Dr. Noble. Dr. Anthony Wutoh is the Provost and Chief Academic Officer of Howard University. He previously served in various roles at the university, including Dean of the College of Pharmacy and Assistant Provost for International Programs. Dr. Wutoh has also served as Director for the Center for Minority Health Services Research and the Center of Excellence. He has a bachelor's degree from the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. He also has a doctorate degree in pharmacy administration at the University of Maryland, Baltimore School of Pharmacy. Now, I know how to follow directions, and so Dr. Wutoh said keep it short, so we're gonna stop right there, but just know that he's very accomplished. He's done research and collected data all around the world, traveled around the world, and has received funding from institutions all around the world as well. So we're looking forward to hearing Dr. Wutoh as he speaks with Dr. Noble. Dr. Safiya Noble is a 2021 MacArthur Fellow, a recipient of the inaugural NAACP Archwell Digital Civil Rights Award, and author of the highly acclaimed Algorithms of Oppression, How Search Engines Reinforce Racism. She is an Internet Studies Scholar and David O. Sears Presidential Endowed Chair of Social Sciences and Professor of Gender Studies and African American Studies at the University of California, Los Angeles, where she serves as the Faculty Director for the Center on Race and Digital Justice and the Co-Director of the Manduro Initiative on Tech and Power, and where she has co-founded the UCLA Center for Critical Internet Inquiry. She and her work have been featured in Time, The Guardian, the BBC, CNN International, Wired, The New York Times, and Rolling Stone, among many others. Her talks and research focus on the ways that digital media impacts our lives and intersects with the issues of race, gender, culture, and technology.
Good morning, Dr. Noble.
Good morning.
And welcome to Howard University.
Thank you.
Before we get started, I'm going to give you an opportunity to shout out. I know in our previous conversation that you are a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated.
I am.
And so I'll let you
shout
out.
Very excited to be here. Thank you. It's really an honor to be at Howard, and I got this beautiful tour this morning from one of my sorors, and just, you know, to see the life and energy at Howard. I went to a predominantly white institution, so there's nothing like this kind of energy and experience, even on a cold day, that my family and I got to experience today. So it's really an honor to be here.
Good. It certainly is an honor to have you as well. Our students may be aware that you are the recipient of a MacArthur Award, otherwise known as a Genius Grant.
It's a lot of pressure. A lot of pressure, though.
And so why don't you share with us a little bit about your story? How did you enter into this journey, and how did you end up in this place in terms of your areas of interest and expertise?
Yeah, thank you. It's been a long journey. I will say that let me start kind of at the beginning though. I grew up in a place called Fresno, California, which is about halfway between Oakland and LA in California. And then grew up kind of my young adult years, most of your ages, the young folks it seems are sitting down here in front, in Oakland. And my first career really was in advertising and marketing. I worked in multicultural and kind of urban marketing. So many of you know that before we had things like internet influencers, we had people who were considered kind of tastemakers or trendsetters. And I worked with those kinds of folks to accelerate uptake of products by Black people and urban consumers. And it was kind of in that work that I really understood what companies were doing in relationship to Black people, Black communities, Black consumers. Many brands, as you can imagine, are negligent when it comes to Black people. Some of them are hyper interested and borderline exploitive, we could say too. So I kind of was interested in how companies with so much power yielded and wielded that power toward us. And when the recession hit, and the mortgage crisis hit in 2006, Black people started feeling it then, and it really kind of was captured as a 2008 mortgage crisis. But a lot of people of color were really feeling the beginnings of the economic downturn. That was the time I went back to graduate school and got a Ph.D. My husband and my son and I, that they're here with me today, we were in Champaign, Urbana. I went to the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And I was so fascinated by the way that people in academia were talking about the internet and tech companies and Silicon Valley, because we just left the Bay Area and I had lived through the first dot-com boom and bust. And it was so different the way people in the university were talking about one company in particular, which was the one that fascinated me the most, which was Google. Google had started to become a household word. It was part of our lexicon, just Google it. Everybody was talking like that. I'm sure many people still are using Google as a part of their everyday experience,
as a noun.
When I would teach my students and I would start to reveal some of the research that I was doing with my undergrad when I was a grad student, they would become hostile because it was like I was talking about their mama. You know, they were like, don't you talk about Google. And so I found this fascinating that one company in the tech sector kind of had a hold on the hearts and minds of people and was such a profound part of the zeitgeist. And many people were thinking about Google as kind of the new public library, or they were thinking of it as kind of a replacement for teachers or experts, that, you know, you could just Google it. You don't need to go learn in an in-depth way about any kind of subject because you could just be reliant upon this technology. And I knew, having just left the ad business, that was off. we were spending thousands and thousands of dollars to game these systems, these search engines, to get our clients placed higher on the first page of results. I understood, this was before we had what we call SEO as an industry, or search engine optimization industry. This was the nascent years of that. And so I thought, well, what are the implications if the public is using search like a reliable, vetted, credible resource? And I knew we had just been spending thousands, and people, companies were spending millions of dollars to manipulate what was happening in those technologies. How's that going to fare for us? And that really was kind of my driving question. So I did an early study, I don't know, it's got to be close to 15 years ago now, where I took the US Census and the racial and ethnic categories, and I combined those with gender categories, and I looked to see what were the results. And this really was kind of, I've almost seen this study fictionalized in television shows now, or I hear people talk about it. But I did these searches on Black women and girls, Latina girls, Asian women. And over and over again, Black women and girls were overrepresented. Over 80% of the search results were pornography or sexual commodified kinds of images or websites. Now, you didn't have to add the word sex, you didn't have to add the word porn. Black girls and women were synonymous with pornography. And that really was, that study was a way for me to show the politics and the power and the implications of how these systems are programmed. What kind of data are they programmed on? What are the implications of the kind of lack of questioning that the public does about what they find? How would Black women and girls in particular ever affect or change that? I mean, when we're looking for that, we're not typically looking for porn when we're using these sites as Black women. What were the implications of this for my daughter, for my son? So that early work really was a claim in fields of information science and computer science, where and sociology, communications, media studies, that algorithms could be programmed in racist and sexist ways, in discriminatory ways, and that the data and that the projects of technical systems like this was social and political. Now, this was heretical at the time to make that claim 15 years ago. I would go into computer science circles men would shout at me and would say, absolutely not, this is impossible. Algorithms aren't political, they're not social, they're just math.
So let me interrupt you briefly.
Yes.
Because one of the thoughts that went through my mind as you're describing that early work is, was this intentional? This, you know, bias that you were seeing,
right,
in the algorithms, was it intentional? Was it a byproduct of the experiences of the developers of the algorithm, and just any thoughts you had about that?
So I'd like to think of the way we assess these systems as really about the disparate impact, irrespective of the intention of the programmer. I think after training computer scientists and people who work in tech and engineering for more than a decade, that there's a high degree of ignorance and lack of knowledge about society, quite frankly. If you think about at a place like UCLA or Illinois, where I've taught, many of the engineering students AP tested out of all their humanities courses. So most of them are kind of walking around on a 12th grade humanities education. They don't take any sociology, ethnic studies, gender studies, any of these kinds of social science courses, because they have a jam-packed computer science curriculum that they have to get through. There might be, if they're lucky, one course on ethics, and it's gonna be woeful at best. So I think the intent is really less of the question, it's more so the lack of knowledge and the ability to see and test for different kinds of outcomes. And the impact of their work on society is so profound.
with really almost no regulatory oversight. I mean, no one's checking on the work until we experience the negative effects of these different kinds of systems. Now, of course, the claims that algorithms or AI could be harmful is, you know, that claim has been like pushing a boulder up a mountain. I mean, it's really been difficult. I would say the majority of people who've led that conversation in the world, in the English-speaking world, let's say, have been Black people, Black women, LGBTQ people, who have been asking different questions of these systems than the makers of the systems. And of course, like the, I think of Black women in particular in the field that I'm in, as like canaries in the coal mine. I mean, we just see things differently. We're asking different questions. We're seeing the effects of a variety of different kinds of predictive systems. What these systems are trying to do is they're trying to predict what they think a user is looking for. So they're using historical data. We're gonna talk about this, I hope, as we go on and maybe talk about newer technologies like generative AI. They're sucking in all the things we know about society that are used as the training data in search, which is the precursor for things like ChatGPT. And there isn't a lot of ability to think critically. I mean, the majority of people in those early days when I would show these results at conferences, they would say, well, this is just what people are looking for. This is the public. This is the public's fault. This isn't the fault of the makers of the technology. Well, we know that's not true. And then we have to ask ourselves as well, well, which users are being prioritized? Who is the imagined user that's looking for porn for Black women about Black women and girls? It's that imagined user is probably not a 15-year-old Black girl. So the question then is, who are the imagined users in the programmers' minds? What is it about the naturalization of this racist and sexist stereotype of the hypersexualized Black woman or girl? We know that this racist and sexist stereotype, its genesis, its origin story is in the end of the transatlantic slave trade, when the only way you could reproduce the enslaved labor force in the Americas was to force Black women and girls to have many children who were born into bondage. So a stereotype emerges that Black women and girls want to have sex more than anyone else, that we want to have a lot of babies. This, its contemporary version is the welfare queen, right? That's the kind of genesis. Melissa Harris Perry has written all about this. There's lots of great Black feminists work around those bell hooks. So it's important to understand the naturalization of stereotypes, which then gets turned into things we call data. A data is a word that flattens these historical experiences, and then it gets naturalized and normalized, spit back to us in something like a search engine, becomes very difficult for people to understand what just happened.
So we're talking about algorithmic discrimination. I'm a pharmacist by profession, and don't have a lot of experience in tech. And I know we have a lot of students here who aren't necessarily from a technology background. In lay terms, what is an algorithm, and how do we get to the point that what is the impact of algorithmic discrimination?
So an algorithm is really a set of instructions that you give to a computer for it to compute. And typically, in the most basic way of thinking about it, it would be instructions that to program a computer to, let's say, work through a decision tree. If these conditions, then those conditions, right, or these types of outputs. It's often working across different kinds of data. An algorithm might be applied to different types of, again, data. I always like to put data in quotey fingers, which might make some of my colleagues in data science frustrated, but I want to do that so that we, again, keep making this word a complex word. An algorithm might be very, very sophisticated and be so complex that even the makers of the algorithm don't quite know how it works. So in the case of search, the search algorithms for big tech companies are so complex, hundreds, if not thousands, of people have worked on them over time. It's not like an old school car where you can just like pull up the hood and you know, like tinker with the carburetor. It's a system where you can't even figure out what piece of code is broken or why we're getting particular outputs. And this is one of the reasons why when, you know, now fast forward, when you do searches on black girls or different kinds of things that I've talked about in the book, most of those things have just been downranked because they really don't know how to fix the system. You know, they have to manually go in. And this happens all the time all over the world with different kinds of platforms where they don't really know why the system does what it does and gives us certain types of outputs. Part of the reason why algorithms, I think, can be discriminatory is because they're often trained on data sets that are also full of discrimination.
And what does that mean?
Okay, so let's say we have, I'm gonna try to go over into your field. Okay. I may be unsuccessful, so you help me. If you have healthcare data and you have 100 years of healthcare data and you train your algorithm to predict who's most likely to, let's say, develop cancer, you're gonna have a very accurate, probably, algorithmic output. You're gonna have output that's gonna probably identify white men with money who've had the best healthcare.
Based on the data that
Because those are the people who are gonna be in the data set,
right?
And all of the black people who didn't make it into the data set, therefore are not gonna get predicted into your output as people who should be pre-screened. So these are the kinds of just very simple ways that algorithmic discrimination happens, which is you have an algorithm that's looking for a set of scenarios or outcomes, and it is looking at data that is gonna be fraught with all kinds of historical patterns.
So maybe one way to think about it is that the algorithm is the starting point, but you have to feed information into the algorithm for it to improve its prediction.
Yeah, it's looking for patterns, right? So typically most of the kinds of algorithms and AI that we experience today are looking, you know, for patterns. And in large scale machine learning kind of algorithms, there might be so much data and that's disconnected and not in a neat data set that it's also looking for patterns that our own human mind would have a hard time finding those kinds of patterns because it might be millions of data points, right? So it'd be very difficult for even large teams of researchers to do that. So we use these kind of machines, these computing methods to help us look for patterns. But the patterns, again, are going to not always tell the full story. Let me give you another example. When Amazon was building an HR software tool because they get tens of thousands of resumes every day at Amazon. And obviously one person or an HR department can't go through 10,000 resumes a day. So they built their own custom AI that would scan resumes and then help them find good employees. So guess what the algorithm that kind of the output was? It screened out 100% of the women. 100% of the women were screened out because the algorithm was looking on certain types of keywords, and also if certain keywords were present on a resume, you were put out. So think about how many women put that they were like, on the women's gymnastics team, or were a member of a sorority, or any kind of thing that was gender identifying. That might be coded negatively, right? Because in their historic data about who's been successful at Amazon, who's been promoted more, who's more likely to go into management, guess what? It's been men. So these kinds of things are really important. And you have HR screeners now. You've been used all over corporate America. Every industry is using these. Universities use them. And it's difficult to understand. Of course, Amazon scrapped that software immediately. Obviously, they knew this was a problem. But when you just go, you know, one level further, you start to see screeners or predictive systems that are going to skew toward a set of results. And if you're not looking at the impact of what those results are, it will be very difficult for you to even know that there's discrimination happening.
And we were discussing this earlier, and I had mentioned that I'm a baker.
You
and,
did.
And I bake as a hobby, and I was trying to use chocolate chip cookies as an example. And really my question was, if the initial algorithm is biased to start, or is discriminatory to start, is there a way to fix that along the way? So my analogy was, if I'm baking chocolate chip cookies and I forget to put chocolate chips in the mix and put them in the oven, I can't then add chocolate chips once I've taken them out of it. Well, I could, but they're not going to be incorporated into the cookie. And is that a reasonable analogy? Can you fix an algorithm that is biased or discriminatory in its construct so that at some point, regardless of how much data you or how you train it, can you adjust for that discriminatory bias?
This is a complex question. And the reason why is because I think there are a lot of different points of view right now in the field about how to mitigate or solve these problems. So your analogy is really interesting of, you know, the recipe. The recipe calls for certain things. You have those inputs and you're going to get a particular kind of output. You could really think of algorithms working in those ways. The challenge here is that there are some computer scientists and people, even in my field in information science, who would say, well, we could see that we didn't get enough of the right kind of output, and we try to solve after the fact.
That also could be used as a justification.
Well,
we've used this very extensive, comprehensive computer database, and this is what we got.
Yes.
And that can be used as a justification, as opposed to suggesting there may be something wrong with the algorithm.
It's difficult because in the case of large companies and small, many times the algorithm or the AI is proprietary. So it's very difficult to know what's happening if you're working in a proprietary kind of system. So all you can study for the people interested in the outcomes, we look at what we got. Did we get enough chocolate chips in there or not? Were they the right kind or not? I think there are people who also would argue that you could change up the recipe and try to make it better. So there are people who work in a field called algorithmic fairness or ethical AI, and they are very interested in these questions of fairness and how do you, let's say, bring in more data of an underrepresented group so that you can kind of mitigate. And this is something statisticians do all the time. I mean, these are also kind of like statistical systems. There are others of us, I would put myself in this S category, who would say, is it appropriate even to use this kind of modeling for this problem? Maybe that's not the appropriate approach. Maybe we don't even want that. One of the best examples of this, just to show the continuum, would be in facial recognition. So facial recognition, you know that the most famous study about discrimination in facial recognition was by my colleagues Joy Bulwamini and Tamit Jabrew, Deb Raji, who did this study called Gender Shades. They're all three black women. Joy was a student at MIT. She has a new book out called Unmasking AI. AI Unmasked. Unmasking AI. She was studying facial recognition when she was a PhD student at MIT. The facial recognition would not recognize her face. She took a white, like, theater mask, like those mime masks. She put it on her face, held it up, facial recognition worked perfectly. They wrote this paper, it's a famous paper now, called Gender Shades, about how facial recognition systems don't recognize black faces. They're worst on black women's faces. They work best on white men's faces. Now, you take a study like that, and there are people who use the study and say, well, let's build better facial recognition systems that see black women's faces and people of color, our faces better, and that's the solution. That's a fairness question. Make the algorithm more fair so it fairly represents everyone's faces. Then there are others of us on, let's say, on the other end of the spectrum who are like, we don't actually need facial recognition technology at all. There's no application of facial recognition technology where there isn't a likelihood of harm or discrimination or surveillance or control that is going to be tied to it. So what we want is to not be recognized. We want less recognition by these systems. And of course, there are movements in Detroit, San Francisco, other places, New York, to ban facial recognition systems, right? Because they're most likely to be used, let's say, in policing scenarios, in border crossing scenarios, in retail scenarios, places where we're already hyper-profiled. So it's contextual when we're talking about fairness. What would be more fair from that vantage point would be no facial recognition software, making that illegal. So this is why I say it's a complex, it's a complex situation. What is fairness in any given scenario with any given technology?
You alluded to this, but I'll raise the point again. Who is policing these systems? Who is really monitoring to limit as much as possible bias and algorithmic discrimination? Is this sort of an industry responsibility, or who is monitoring these processes now, and what are your thoughts about what we should be doing?
Simone Brown, who wrote this incredible book called Dark Matter, Dark Matters, says her handle on Twitter and social media is We Watch Watchers, and I would say that it's people like us, you know, scholars, activists, journalists who are watching, who have been kind of in the forefront of naming the problems, which is deeply unsatisfactory. I mean, for us, most of us are public servants. We, you know, I work for UCLA, I work for the state of California. I'm not really paid to be a watchdog on the tech industry, even though that is what my research is about. It's, you know, it's like a drop in the bucket compared to what's rolling out every day, every week, every month. So we don't really have in the US a robust regulatory environment yet that's developing. I would say the two most important agencies right now are the Federal Trade Commission, led by Lena Khan, who, if you don't know, is a law professor before President Biden named her to chair the FTC, and she wrote the most important paper about why we should break up Amazon as a monopoly. So you know what her orientation is at the FTC. She's like, I'm coming for you, big tech. And that's important because the FTC puts the guardrails in place for the public, for consumers. That's their orientation. If there are harmful consumer products, they're on it. That's difficult. Obviously, you're in D.C. You know better than I do how difficult it is to do things in D.C. legislatively and in a regulatory agency. I would say the other agency that's very important right now is the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau, led, directed by Rohit Chopra, who was formerly of the FTC, an amazing, incredible advocate for communities and for disenfranchised people. And he has really led the charge around things like investigations of data brokers. Data brokers are companies who take all the information that can be gathered about us, everything you're doing on your phone, everything, everywhere you are. That's a big market that where information about us, data about us is sold 24/7, thousands of data brokers. They are building complex data profiles on all of us. And the CFPB is trying to really crack down on that as well and make that illegal. In California, we have the California Consumer, the privacy protection agency. So at state levels, we're starting to see some traction and action around regulation, but I would say we're nowhere near Europe with the kind of EU and GDPR and other kinds of policies. And the frameworks are limited also around regulation, because regulation in most countries is organized around individual rights. But, you know, we understand collective and community rights. So it's very difficult if you're discriminated against by some type of AI and you have to litigate that or take a company to court or, you know, try to have like civil claims. We don't really have criminal statutes yet, so we need Congress to pass legislation, and the environment's difficult. But what about when we're like collectively as a community experiencing some type of disparate impact? That's much more difficult. We don't really have the right laws in place yet for those protections. So what happens is, like we know, working people, poor people, middle class people cannot afford, no one here is going to sue Google. Okay, that's not going to happen because we don't have, not successfully, because we don't have the resources and the armies of lawyers that we would need to win. What we've really been reliant upon have been very famous people suing companies and trying to get some type of statute on the books that then maybe in 10 years we'll be able to use to our benefit. But I think that is not really a sufficient way. It's reactive. It puts us on our back foot. What we need is proactive frameworks of protection, like we do, let's say, with environmental protection. You know, none of us should have to litigate to get clean air or clean water. That should just be a right, a human right, a civil right that we get to experience and enjoy because those protections have been put in place. And that's really, to me, a much healthier and more robust way to think about regulating.
The underlying technologies behind artificial intelligence, especially over the last year, seem to be advancing rapidly. Is the genie out of the bottle? Is it too late at this point to really put in place frameworks that protect against bias and that protect against algorithmic discrimination? Or do we still have time to really try to manage the genie?
Well, I try to think at the level of paradigm, and because that's really where my work, it's like kind of like shifting the way we thought about it before and how we'll think about it going forward. You know, before algorithms were just math, and then shifting that to like, no, algorithms are political and social, right? So is the genie out of the bottle? Well, really the technologies are here, certainly. What can we know about them that might shift the way we see them? I'll give you an example that we all can kind of understand. So when the technology of the automobile was introduced, there was, this was incredible, especially for Black people. Like our ability to move prior to the 1950s, when automobiles started to like become mainstream, was in the 1960s, was really difficult. And we couldn't move everywhere either. Not only was it just not safe, but there were constraints. And then you have the automobile and you can like pile up in the car, and inside that space, there's some safety and there's all kinds of new freedoms. And then we build different kinds of networks, you know, the green bug, we have like all these different ways of taking advantage of a technology like that. And yet inside a sense of freedom that we think we have with the automobile, we have all these other secondary and tertiary effects that might not be obvious to us, like climate change. We're dealing right now with we're in the generation of dealing seriously with climate change from oil and gas and what automobiles and kind of corporate pollution have done. We would not have been able to have automobiles around the world and buses and all this kind of transportation dependent upon it without the incredible extraction of rubber, right, from you know, the Belgians were like vicious colonizers, and what happened to people in order to export rubber. So we have a Pan-Africanist way of thinking about the automobile now, if we think about our relationship to the continent, and of course then to the waste, what happens. We know when there's waste in the world, it goes back to our people, our communities, all over in the US and abroad. So I think of the technology moment that we're in right now around digital technologies, network technologies, as being similar in that there are certain affordances and freedoms that people are feeling and experiencing with them. And there are also these other costs that are hidden from view on purpose, all right? So our job, especially here, is to think about how we would do these things differently. You know, so I tell my students all the time, like, they're like, Dr. Noble, I made this new app, will you try it? And I'm like, I don't want to hear about the app. You know, I'm like, I want you to bring me back a phone that when we're done with it, we can eat it. Or like plant a tree, you know, I mean, put it in the ground and something grow from it. Like really, we gotta get a totally different paradigm about this so that the network devices, the Internet of Things, all the things that we're dealing with aren't dependent on mining minerals from the Congo and extractive mineral industries and e-waste being shipped to Ghana and ruining pristine, beautiful wetlands in the heart of the city and Accra. We have to actually think, and this is where I think Black people, we have the superpower of thinking in these ways about an ecosystem and our relationship to other people in the world, and then we can innovate differently. And to me, that is a huge opportunity that our counterparts are not thinking about.
Let's shift the conversation
okay.
a little bit. It's an election year. And, you know, we hear a number of
I thought things. It was already depressing, and now you're taking it there. So here we go.
What is being done that we either may not be aware of, or we hear snippets of things? What is your concern regarding artificial intelligence, particularly as it relates to elections in this country or in other countries? What things sort of stand out to you that we need to be thinking about, we need to be concerned about, are already being utilized that we just may not even have awareness of?
Okay, well, we know that Facebook has ruined electoral politics in most liberal Western democracies, including this one in the United States. We see a huge rise in authoritarian politics around the world that is mostly facilitated by large-scale social media platforms. That is getting worse. Facebook, 2 weeks ago, I think now, declared, maybe it was last week or week before, that they are going to ban political speech as a way of supporting democracy. This is nothing could be further from the truth, because what will happen now is that journalists will not be able to report and have their material seen. So it can be posted, but it won't be amplified algorithmically. We have lots of evidence. January 6th, you know, white supremacist uprising against the United States government, the backlash against President Barack Obama and the election of Donald Trump. We have a huge industry of bots and other kinds of interference from other parts of the world in US politics, many times operating under the guise of being Black people and Black women. You know, the work of Shereen Mitchell, who was the first person who really recognized these kind of fake accounts that were pretending like they were Black women, yet like using AAVE and trying to engage in politics, and really are just straight up voter suppression kinds of accounts. Also pretending to be Black people and Black women to whip up white nationalists and white supremacists in the United States. And of course, that's because Black women are the, you know, most reliable voter demographic in the United States in terms of Democratic politics. So I think we should expect that is going to intensify. It's being refined with these new policies coming out of Facebook, which you want to remember, 80% of the user base of Facebook is outside of the United States. And most of the people, especially on the continent and other places that are using Facebook, that is their experience of the internet. Inside the closed ecosystem of Facebook, that is what they experience as the internet. So I think we are going to have a lot of tough work ahead of us in this next presidential election. That is the most polite way I can say it, because really I am not sleeping at night. I'm asking my husband, we're like, where are we moving? Are we moving? Is everyone leaving? Where's everyone going? If we're staying, where are we staying? What are we doing? Everybody moved to California, because I feel like we could go it alone if it really got, you know, hectic. Maybe DC too. So these are some of the challenges. I think we should be expecting more voter suppression. Listen, when you see rappers and you see artists who are like, hey, you know, all the candidates are terrible choices, I'm just going to sit it out, that's a voter suppression tactic. Okay, just straight up on its face, like that is what is going on. And so we should expect to see a lot of that in this next election. And this next election, I think, is extremely consequential for us. We've already seen a massive rollback of civil rights legislation in our lifetime, which is just stunning. And a Supreme Court that has moved to the far right. And I think we should expect to see more of that if we do not get involved. The only thing that is really giving me life right now is seeing the Gen Zs that are running for Congress. Could y'all keep running for Congress? Like, you know, like just getting out there and really building some type of progressive caucus. I think it's super important. I'm saying this now, not as a professor. I'm just saying this me, unplugged with just what I feel is happening. I think it's really important. It's easy to give up on electoral politics. When I was a young person, I did not believe in electoral politics. I was really like, just like, scam, you know, it's not doing what it needs to do for us. It's not doing what it needs to do for us. It's going to do even worse. It's going to do even less. You know, it'll actually become extremely harmful, like explicitly damaging and targeting. And I think that, you know, we should think of that as one of many fronts that we need to make sure we shore up, and ensuring that we don't have, you know, a fascist takeover of the U.S. government.
What are algorithmic election systems, if you can?
Oh my gosh! Well, I was recently. This is what I do in my spare time. I watch old Davos talks from tech leaders, which is the most hideous thing you can do. So don't do that. But I'm here to report out that. In 2017, one of the last ones I watched, Sergey Brin, who's the co-founder of Google, was being interviewed at Davos on the main stage. And he was asked about the future of elections. And you know what he said? He said, in the future, we will have so much information about people, we can predict what kind of candidates, which candidates they would vote for anyway, so we won't need elections.
I've seen a movie like that.
I know. That's the future they imagine for us. And he's not wrong. They do have that much information about us. In fact, people, when they ask people about their search results, would they want anyone to know about their search results? Like, you know, 90% of the public is like, absolutely not. Do not tell anybody what I'm searching for. And that's really important. But Google and Facebook both would say they know us better than our own spouses or our parents or... And that is consequential for us.
And they commoditize that information.
They commoditize it, they sell it, they use it. And you know it if you open up Instagram and it's just really got your number with the skincare and the bags and the shoes. I don't know. Is that what my Instagram is giving me? I thought I was giving everybody that. They know, and they're extremely effective. Shoshana Zuboff, in her book, The Age of Surveillance Capitalism, describes it as total behavioral manipulation, that we are living, we're moving into this era of capitalism, that we are just under total behavioral manipulation. She doesn't have like a racial capitalism kind of critique that is missing, but I will say we are so astute about living under systems of oppression that we should be able to outmaneuver, outsmart, work around, refuse the worst of, that these systems have, and figure out what's the best that can work in our interests.
Do you have time for a few questions?
Sure, let's do it.
All right, that's good, good. We're going to be able to take questions for Dr. Nobles if you have any questions that you would like to ask. And I'm not sure if we'll be taking questions online.
Maybe in the back. I'm
okay.
I don't want to upset the students, but you know.
Sure.
Please.
Fascinating talk. I really listened to every word. I'm on the edge of my seat. Everything you said. I guess I want to go back to for you to think about coming on the root causes of algorithmic bias. And the way I think about it, and see if it makes sense to you, is that algorithms are created by people. And people bring to the job of that level of creativity, they're what I call their experiential DNA.
Yes.
Of what have created them all their life until that moment. And then they use that to see the problem. And when they see the problem, they use that to write an algorithm to solve the problem. And if their total lifetime experience DNA is biased, they might even know it's biased, but they're gonna write a biased algorithm to solve that problem. Because that's the world they see. So this is a long-term solution. For example, if you had more blacks and women writing algorithms, they have a different experiential DNA.
For sure.
So that might fix some of the problem, but it's a long time. You gotta invest in it. Like you know, it takes a long time to make a doctor, but once you made one, you made one. Could you comment on that some?
Mitigating bias, right, or limiting bias, or you know, in fact, trying to do away with bias, algorithmic bias, which is, I think, not the project. There's no scenario where there are not values present. So if you set the word bias for values, you would know that we have to name the values that we want. We have to name the problems that we want to solve. We have to scope the range of solutions that we think are viable and program for that. And that's really a different project than trying to not see bias. So let's, you know, we know from the research around things like colorblind ideology, for example. The psychologists who study colorblind ideology show again and again that people who say, I don't see color, I have a colorblind worldview, are more likely to be racist, more likely to tolerate racism in their presence. Every study bears this out. So we don't want people who say, I don't see bias in algorithms, or I make unbiased algorithms, because to me it's reflective of this like gender colorblind sensibility. What we want are people who say, I understand the problems. I understand things like oppression, like disparity, discrimination, economic. I understand capitalism. I understand like lots of patriarchy, name the system. And I'm designing to mitigate or solve for that. For those, we don't want those values. We want this different set of values. And we're going to design products and projects in service of that. That is a completely different type of language than the prevailing language and this is one of the reasons why these conversations are so important. For sure, when I talk to Black folks in tech, they're just asking different questions. Mm-hmm. They're thinking about different products.
So doesn't that also suggest that it is even more critically important to bring a variety of perspectives
Absolutely.
To the table as these algorithms are being developed and as these decisions are being made? I think I made great decisions, but I wouldn't necessarily make the same ones that you would make. But having that broad perspective and having that range of experiences, you know, I think it's important to your work that your underlying background was not in technology. And right. So you brought an entirely different skill set from someone whose basis of framing maybe as an engineer or as a computer scientist. Right. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but having that additional perspective helps to bring that important voice to the table.
I think interdisciplinarity is the least resourced word in the university, and it's probably the most important approach to training students and preparing future tech workers in particular. You know, in my book, one of the interventions I call for is interdisciplinary teams in these companies with people who have the same amount of power as the computer scientists on the team, that they're not just like the frosting or they're like additive at the very end, you know, but they're not the cookies, the chocolate chips that didn't get baked in. People with degrees in African American studies, Chicano Latino studies, Indigenous studies, gender studies, sociology, psychology, political science, literature, English, people who have training in the complexity of the human experience are the best people to be working on teams in any company, in any industry, in any product, but especially consequential products like tech products, because the project of classification, of classifying and sorting people so that you can then build software or different kinds of products, right, that engage with those classifications, they're often very rudimentary, they're banal, they're really not complex. I think about all the time, would we have had the mortgage crisis? Would we have even had a paradigm where investors could sell subprime mortgages to your parents or your grandparents and then bet on their likelihood of failing to make those payments and get rich off of that? Like, if Black people had been on Wall Street, absolutely not. We would have never, no. Okay, because we would have refused on the face of it, because we would have known the people and the kinds of people that were being preyed upon. Those were our people. So that is really valuable. Now, it's not valuable if you want to exploit people and make money off of them, but it's really valuable if you want to be in a company or you want to start a company or you want to work with people who are doing things that are about justice in our society. So these interdisciplinary teams, I mean, I think if you had somebody like who's got deep expertise in Black literature on your team, who's just like, I know the stories of Black people. I know the richness. I know the complexity. What a contribution would that be if you were on some type of, you know, product team? I say that all the time in Silicon Valley, so now you don't have to show up and get those jobs. I don't know. I mean, these are the kinds of tensions that I think they're grappling with, and they need to grapple with, because their products are dangerous.
Oh, questions. Okay, let me move.
Hello, is this working?
And if you could introduce yourself.
Of course. So hi, everyone. My name is Ellie Warden. I'm a psychology major, and I take a class, stats class with Dr. Majors. So I don't like public speaking, so this is my first time. But just process with me as I get my words out. Basically, I'm very much interested in psychology, and what stuck out to me was when you said that we had to change the paradigm from technology to environmental like sustainability. And I definitely agree with you on that idea, because as I'm studying psychology, I'm more invested in how could we create like just the positive effects of nature, you know, and how could we build more green spaces around our environment, because technology is just, I think that takes us away from our natural existence. And I would love for you to say more about that. Like, what do you think changing the paradigm look like in terms of creating environmental sustainability?
Well, first of all, let me just say thank you for your first time public speaking and being here. And that was a beautiful processing live. I think you're really right that obviously nature has a huge impact on people. It's one of the reasons why I think I was recently reading a study about wealthy people, you know, the square footage of trees, for example, in grass in wealthy areas versus not wealthy working class areas. So we know that access to trees and clean oxygen and all of those things are amazing for our brain and for our health and for our well-being, for our psyche. And there is a movement that of biophilia. I have a colleague, Dr. Vita Ramsey in Los Angeles, who's working on this, bringing more green space into urban schools, for example, in LA Unified, black schools. So important. It's also grounding. So we know, for example, that we need to touch grass to be grounded. Like, legit, you need to go touch grass. I have a sweatshirt from the Cyber Collective, which is this amazing collective of women of color who work in tech, and you should follow them. They go by Psycho. And they made a sweatshirt that says touch the grass, and I wear it all the time. And the reason is because we know that we've got to disconnect. And the more connected we are, in fact, the more depressed we are, just the more likely we are to be manipulated, and we're just giving over more information that we don't necessarily need to do. So that's really important, this idea of connecting with the earth. It also, I think, gives us a different sense of possibilities. So, you know, there's this great book called Literacy with an Attitude, by Finn is the last name, and he talks about education, how education happens. And so it's like, if you're like a poor student, working poor student, you sit in rows in a classroom, you take a multiple choice test or Scantron, right, when you're learning about Peru, Lima, Peru, you know everything you need to know. And if you're a middle class student, you get to do a PowerPoint. And you might work in a group project, and maybe you sit in pods in your classroom, and that's how you learn. And if you're a rich kid,
you go to Peru!
Okay, and that's how you learn about it. All right, so this is how education works in this country. And I think when you look at what happens in the tech sector, they don't let their kids get on social media. Their kids have limited screen time. The nannies have to sign NDAs that say, you won't put my kid on the internet. No phones, no screens, anything allowed. They're kids, the elite, the Silicon Valley elite. This is how they live. So they know what you know, which is being out in nature and being disconnected is actually healthy. Even Bill Gates said he wouldn't let his kids get on computers. All right? Lord, help us. So
What does that tell you?
I know. What does it tell you? I'm calling on Black Jesus every day. Do you understand when I say these stories? So I think that we have to always have the interventions, the counterweights, the alternatives, the other kinds of possibilities. So what you're talking about is really important. And we do see paradigm shifting happening, because I see younger and younger people kind of being not as connected, let's say, as millennials and Gen Xers have been. So that's positive. But I think we have to keep talking. And one thing that excites me about like the Gen Zs and the youngers is
you know, they're just disgusted with how we've left the world, you know, as they should be. And I'm disgusted. I'm Gen X, so you know I'm disgusted and through. So I think, you know, we have to keep building these kind of different kinds of paradigms. And again, thinking about, like, you know, what is this thing? You know, it's some glass, it's some plastic, it's some minerals, it's some metal. How much time do I want to spend with it? And then resisting, you know, don't let Elon Musk put a Neuralink in your brain. You know what I'm saying? Like, absolutely not on that front as well. We should be cherry picking the very best of these possibilities that are good for humanity. And we should have our analog counterpart to it. So while we understand certain forms of knowledge are accessible to us, what's the knowledge that's also in our mind that we pass on through oral traditions and other things that if the power grid goes down, we still have it. It can't be taken away from us, right? Our libraries and our other, and ourselves, investing in ourselves. That's also really a powerful part of nature too. Thank you.
That's good.
Okay, hi, my name is Amira Allen. I play basketball here. I'm a psychology major, econ minor, and I'm also in stats. So my question for you, I wrote it down because I have a tendency to overtalk, and it is, what occupation should Gen Z pursue to maximize our ability in outmaneuvering this behavioral manipulation that you speak of, especially in light of this AI, you know, taking our jobs?
Yeah, I mean, you know, there'll be different jobs than the jobs of before. And I think that we're gonna see expertise be extremely valuable. So think about how more than 50% of the things that ChatGPT gives back to you right now are just patently false, okay?
What is that statistic?
It's more than 50%. It depends on what you're asking, but more than 50%. So anybody in here who is an expert, all your professors, who go write a syllabus in your field, and then you see these fake citations come back, and you're like, that's actually not. I mean, I don't know who Jennifer Noble is, who wrote algorithms of things. That's not real. You know what I mean? So that's like, I know Noble is somewhere in there, but no, it's not her. So there's lots of that kind of thing happening. So experts are going to be very important. In a world that is going to increasingly, industries are going to become more and more dependent on different types of AI, and some of it is just going to be unusable, and you're going to need people who have a deep expertise who can verify the veracity, okay? So become an expert in anything, get as much education as you can in the thing that you love and that you care about. That will be valuable. Everybody should go to grad school. Okay, I said it. Even if you think you don't like school, I promise you that grad school is so different than undergrad. I mean, undergrad is the price you pay to get to go to grad school. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's so amazing and fun because you're only talking about the thing you want to talk about, and you don't have to do all the other stuff. So.
And that's a plug for our master's
degree. I'm telling everybody, you can get a master's at Howard and also get a PhD. All right, so that's one thing that I think you can do. I think staying really broad and exposed to a lot of different kinds of thinking, and go deep, as deep as you can in different areas. I think that's going to be very valuable. Being a great critical thinker, I mean, you cannot put a price tag on that, because you will see things that other people cannot see. And develop the skill of knowing your own voice and hearing it and loving it, okay? Really have a voice. Don't lay back. Everybody's here for a reason. You know things that other people don't know. You're on this tour around the planet for a reason. You are not inconsequential, is what I'm saying. And you have to, you know, I wish that I knew myself the way I know myself now when I was younger, when I was your age, to be honest. Be a leader. Get involved in things. Join things. If things aren't interesting enough for you to join, make things and bring others along. all those skills are the skills to be able to show up somewhere and be powerful on your own terms with those things. They're really important. Follow the right people. You know, be a leader and a follower. I follow lots of great thinkers, their works. You know, be a reader. These are, honestly, they seem so basic. Am I like 1,000 years old saying these things? I don't know. I just think they're great skills for life. And the thing of it is, when I was in my 20s, I was like an undergrad and I was thinking about majoring in something, I thought there was like a direct straight line between the major and my life. You know what I mean? Yeah, I know you know what I mean. It's like, it's not really that. And then I figured out that I was too much of a troublemaker in history as a history major, and I was pissing too many people off in there talking about, well, what about black people? And they were like, we're not doing that in here. That I became a sociology major, and I see myself as a sociologist because I just wanted to sit around and talk about current affairs and what was going on in the world. That thing was the thing that I loved to do, so I majored in the thing that was like the thing I liked to do. And don't worry about the straight line to a job. Just follow the hunches, the instincts, the things you're good at. I thought I wanted to be a doctor, but I can't stand blood or any bodily fluids, quite frankly. And I had a professor who was like, what is wrong with you? Why would you think you're going to be a doctor and you can't handle any of these things? And I was like, because the world needs doctors. And he was like, but not you. You know what I'm saying? Not you. Because what the world needs are people who want to be doctors because they're talented in that. What are you talented in? That's what you go do and enjoy and contribute through. You might be like the next big WNBA player and have a big platform for change. And maybe that's what we need too, right? So there's no occupation in here that you're interested in that isn't the right one. They're all right? Except for like making like drones that kill people. I'm gonna put that off limits, no drone making, no like working for Department of Defense. But short of that, go do your thing, all right? You got it.
Another question.
Hello, thank you for that. My name is Jimmer Wilson. I'm a web developer on the UX/WS team here. And so thinking about your chocolate chip analogy, right? We've already made a lot of progress as like black people in the tech space. Do you think there's a value add in us like creating our own stuff entirely? Like
absolutely.
No more Google, just black it up. We just all of our stuff and then pour it back in so we kind of have new data sets to work from.
So you got the chocolate chips in at the beginning.
Well, we just making new cookies.
Right. Make new cookies.
I 100% think that we have to innovate differently. I think there are unlimited opportunities for us to not just go work in Silicon Valley and Silicon corridors that are like have like well-worn grooves from certain universities into the Valley. We see a lot of new black VC firms coming up that are trying to have different models that are not just looking for like the hockey stick of growth and don't want to just take everything from you once you've made it. I think that's important. So people who become investors can have different kinds of investment models where social impact, for example, is one of the criteria for investing. Proving no harm of your product. I think where it's exciting to see black people in the tech space is thinking and dreaming of not just black Facebook, but things that have like our culture and sensibilities and also maybe our politics. So again, I said this word Pan-Africanist earlier, but I really believe there's so much growth on the continent right now. And that is really the heart of where so many of the resources are and possibilities for doing things differently. So we shouldn't have a genocide happening in the Congo that's fueled by big tech companies who need minerals, who use all these like third party intermediaries to remove themselves from direct implication.
we shouldn't have, like, you know, crises in Rwanda. We shouldn't, you know, like, the region is beset by the politics of not just U.S. imperialism, but also the way that our industries continue to do kind of this colonial business. So I think bring that knowledge to bear in doing business differently, too. That's also really important. And, you know, I've been meeting more and more people who have great ideas about how to use technology to do something different, which is not the same thing as just being a Black person who gets trained in the same old way as everyone else and just goes and works in those companies uncritically. But, you know, bring the kind of critical political thinking to it. It's important. And again, that might be, you know, you might, maybe you'll invent the things, you know, maybe we will invent the things like that we already see happening. Like, okay, one of my dreams, I'm just giving it to the room. You can do whatever you want with it because I'm too old. I'm not going to do it. But like, where's the RFID blocking clothing line? Where's the facial recognition blocking makeup line? You know, where's the cool stuff that could also be super profitable and that, you know, are like grounded in, again, some of the sense of things that we might innovate differently that would be valuable all over the world, trust me. So I don't know, I think it's like, and then of course, if you're, you know, an anthropologist or you're a sociologist or psychologist, making great data that people can act upon, that it has the kind of thoughtful sensitivity and knowledge, you know, baked in that people can use.
We have time maybe for one more question.
Hi. Hi, I'm Rihanna. I was wondering, I have just wanted to stay on that point about, you know, you're talking a lot more about the diaspora and thinking about, I was thinking a lot lately about the sort of changing face of the continent, the African continent, about how in 2050, one in four people on the planet will be African, and like there's this young, very young population there as well, where I think the median age currently is about 19. And I was kind of thinking about, you know, to that previous question about the changes in technology and where we're putting our labor, and these two questions about, like, you know, the idea of making separatist social, you know, information stuff versus like changing the face of the tech that we're currently using. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to like that sort of more global aspect of it and like what that might look like, because sometimes when I think we talk about, obviously I'm British, and sometimes when we talk about the like tech and oppression in tech and race in tech, like often the worldview like tends to be very America focused, and like, you know, sometimes I'm thinking like about how the rest of the diaspora uses tech. Like, so the example I'm thinking of is like Spill, right? The Spill, I looked at that and I was like, oh, that is probably not my type of blackness that they're talking about here. And like, this isn't something that necessarily is going to appeal to people who are using, like thinking about what social media platform to move to, and they're coming from like, I don't know, the Caribbean or the UK. So I'm kind of thinking about that. I was wondering if you could speak to that at all.
I love that because I really, I know the one of the founders of Spill, and you know, it's so new, I think, give it a beat, and it probably, I mean, it already has like a kind of a big diasporic user base, and I think that's gonna grow, and I think there is gonna be more for different kinds of blackness to be experienced on Spill, so at least I'm watching to see if that's true. That's also an interesting company, and one of the reasons I have met them is because, well, I don't know if this is true, but this is what they told me. They read a book like Algorithms of Oppression, and they read that book and others, and they were like, how do we make a company based on the things we learned in these kinds of books? So I find that super fascinating, and I'm watching them. You know, I would just nuance the idea that these spaces also are kind of separatist, because the truth is, when you look at every major platform, not just in the tech space, but you could even move over to like legacy media, like network television, different kinds of television, cable television, all of them launch off of Black people and Black culture. So Twitter was like, it was for the nerds at work. like literally in Silicon Valley, they were just like using it at work to kind of talk to each other. Then they'd go home, and at night, all the black teenagers would come on and would start using hashtags to organize conversations. And then Silicon Valley would come back to work the next day, and they were like, what just happened? What is going on in here? And black people took over and actually made Twitter what Twitter is. You could say the same thing for Vine, which doesn't exist anymore, but you know, for sure TikTok, no question. So the question to me is, given the way black culture is used, not just in the US, but also British black folks, to seed and grow platforms, the question is why are we like a disposable user base in that equation and in the math of that, right? So we actually don't see any return back from that. So I think the companies that are started by black folks in the space are really trying to center what is already centered in other platforms, but we're not the shareholders in those companies. And I think that's a very different and innovative model. It's still, you know, understanding like the power of black culture is very, very, black culture is the world's culture. You can't, there's no getting around that any which way you slice it up, but especially in the United States, our culture is at the epicenter. In advertising, we used to call it selling to and through. So selling to the general market, which is anybody, which is like i.e. white America, through black people. It's why Dr. Dre is doing the Coors commercial. Black people are not drinking Coors, okay? But Dr. Dre's there, and now that ad is like playing in the Super Bowl. You understand what I'm saying? So these kinds of things are very important for us to understand in terms of the cultural and political and economic import of black people, black culture, black ideas, black identity, and then what are the models, the business models that can wrap around that, that also then benefit black communities? Those are really, really difficult questions, but they're hard to implement because most of the resources are sequestered, right? Like the investment and startup capital. But I think we have to keep pushing in all of these different ways, you know? We need artists to keep making art and to be mindful and knowledgeable about data science. Like the artists should be taking the data science courses to understand the valuation of their art when it gets into a network system like the internet. So there's nobody who's not going to benefit from having like this kind of deep knowledge and then thinking about ways that we're going to maximize that, you know, inside like the potentials that we imagine.
As we wrap up, and I know that there are a few more questions, but we really will need to wrap up. I want to make a couple of acknowledgments. First of all, I want to thank each of you for being here, primarily our students, but we have a number of staff and faculty who are here as well. I want to acknowledge the MasterCard Impact Fund, who has sponsored this program, our Center for Applied Data Science and Analytics, and Bill Sutherland is the director for that center. And we've talked about our master's degree in Applied Data Science and Analytics, and Dr. Amy Yeboah Kwakume is the program director for the graduate program. Certainly want to also acknowledge and thank the Office of the Provost and our Office for Academic Innovation and Strategic Initiatives, and Kiana Skipwith is in the back. And so please join me in giving a special round of applause to Dr. Safiya Noble. Thank you. I know she has a plane to catch.
I think we're doing a book event with some students.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
I don't know if there's an announcement about that or if you know who you are, but we are going to talk about the book a little bit. But thank you. I just want to say thank you. This is really special to me. This is the first time I've spoken at HBCU. I don't know why that is.
Oh, welcome home.
But thank you. I feel really honored, and this was a really meaningful, special day for me.
Oh, thank you. It certainly was an honor for us to have you as well.
Thank you.
Thank you for the conversation. Yeah. 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 Ye